Hello, this is Sophomore Astrology. My name is Sarah, and for this video, I'm going to talk about sun and moon aspects. So be sure to like, share, and subscribe to my channel, and also check me out on Instagram. And I also have a website where I have a blog, and you could also check out, or you can book a natal chart reading with me too, if you would like to do that as well. So to just get straight into the video, I'm going to first kind of give an overview of what the sun and the moon mean. And then literally the word aspect, or when I'm talking about aspects, I'm just talking about two planets' relationship to each other. You know, how do the sun and moon relate depending on what aspect might be in your chart? And honestly, even if you don't have any sun or moon aspects in your chart, I feel like this video is good to just talk about the polarity of feminine and masculine energies, you know, because honestly, while I was studying these aspects, I noticed that you could kind of see this either in synastry with other people. When you compare two people's charts, you can kind of predict how maybe how ego play is going to play out in a relationship. Also too, to understand yourself when it comes to your own masculine and feminine energies, because when it comes to feminine and masculine energies, we all have those energies within us, regardless of our gender or our sex. Because if you think about just astrology in general, we all have a sun and moon placement. And with that, I just want to kind of get into the video. Now, the sun represents king of the stars. You know, the sun is considered the father figure. It's a very masculine, very hot and dry planet. The thing about the sun, though, it is of light. You know, it's not like Mars with the Mars series that I've done so far. Mars destroys, but the sun gives life. It gives vitality. It definitely, you need the sun to survive here on planet Earth. Without the sun, you know, a lot of plant life would not grow and flourish. And, you know, honestly, too, if people don't have enough sun, it definitely can affect their happiness and their mood. So when we're talking about the sun represents authority, power, and ego. And as I'm talking in this video, the sun can simply represent something as simple or as just, it could be something as simple as like just your father figure in your life or the masculine figure in your life. Because, I mean, you could have a masculine figure without it actually them having to be male. And that's what I'm kind of speaking to. So it could be, you know, as concrete as like your dad or the masculine parent in your life or the masculine person who took care of you as you were a kid. Or it could be just as abstract as something as like your masculinity, your divine masculine energy within yourself. You know, and also too, this could apply to the sun sign, could also apply to the masculine person in a relationship as well, or the person who kind of plays out that energy more. So there's that for the sun, you know. Then we have the moon. Now, the moon is a feminine, cold, moist planet. The moon is considered Lady of the Night. The moon represents cyclical processes, you know, birth, growth, and decay. I also think of just like, I think of just like pregnancy in general, you know, just the planting of the seed and how it grows and how it's like kind of birthed out. And it's just, think about the cycle of life, you know. And the moon represents like feminine energy. It is the planet of feminine energy. It represents the mother, the wife, the queen. So you can kind of think as the sun is the king and the moon is the queen of the sky. Also, you can think of like yin and yang. You know, these two planets are very important to the life on this planet. You know, because the moon definitely controls like the water of this planet. And, you know, Earth cannot survive without water. Humans, living things cannot survive without water. And living things cannot survive without the sun. Both of those planets are just as equally as important, because if we didn't have one or the other, life could, you know, cease as we know it on planet Earth. So I want you to like kind of think about that, because there's a polarity between light and dark, and you can't have one without the other. You can't have darkness without light, and you can't have light without darkness. They both must exist. It must coexist for them to both exist. So to get into it, the first aspect I want to talk about is sun conjunct moon, or the sun in conjunction with the moon. Now, with this aspect, I thought it was interesting because if you check out both of my videos, the one about Nipsey Hussle and the other one about Amy Winehouse, both of them had their sun in conjunction with moon, which basically means that the sun and the moon are on the same page. You know, they're pretty much like, that means like both the sun and the moon are in the same sign, you know, so someone could have their sun and their moon in Leo. Or someone could have their sun and moon in Scorpio, you know, something like that, where it's just like both the sun and the moon are in the same zodiac sign. So you could kind of think of it like the conscious and the unconscious mind understand each other. They identify with each other because they are of the same energy. They are of the same zodiac sign. It's almost like their sun sign is amplified in a way, because it's like not only is there conscious willpower of of the Virgo sign, but it's also like their moon, their emotionality, their unconscious self, it's like their wants and their needs are coming kind of from the same sign or the same place, the same energy. These people are very focused in life. They don't have 5-10 things that they might want to do with their life. It's very simple for them to narrow it down, focus in, and kind of achieve what they want to achieve in this lifetime. They know what they want. These people easily know what they want in life. But also, too, the thing about this is that because the sun and the moon are coming from the same energy, it's very subjective. It's almost like the sun and the moon both have like the same perspective, you know, they're looking from the same window. So they're going to kind of like mirror each other in a way where it's just like, it's just focused on itself and their own wants and needs, to the point where they're not going to really, really focus or understand the needs and wants of other people, but they know what they need and want, you know? So these people can kind of come off very selfish. And when we're talking about a relationship aspect, it's like these two people might be very selfish with It's like both people might be very selfish if this was an aspect in someone's synastry chart between two people. One person might know what they want and need. The other person might know what they want and need, but both people don't really kind of understand how the give and the take in the relationship can happen. You know, they know what they need to be given. They know what they need to be, what needs to be received to them, but they might not know the other way around. That ebb and flow between two people, it might be a little difficult between two people who have this aspect. And also, too, I just want to mention, too, that people with this aspect, they either were born on a new moon or just before a new moon. So that's why they're able to kind of really set their intentions like you're supposed to. Like, you don't have to, but it's good to set your intentions before a new moon, because then you're able to kind of like have a fresh look for the next 2 weeks before the next full moon to really kind of like plan and make things happen and really try to hone in on your goals for that, for the next 2 weeks. These people have just like that spirit within them innately to just really set out what they want to set out. Now, the next aspect I want to talk about is sun sextile moon. Now, that means like the sun and the moon, they're at 60 degrees different from each other. And basically it means that these two, both the sun and the moon are in signs that are of the same gender. Now, when I mean the same gender, when we're talking about astrology, is that water signs and earth signs. Water meaning Scorpio, Pisces, and Cancer. Water signs are feminine. And then when it comes to earth sign, Virgo, Capricorn, and Taurus, those signs are all considered feminine signs. Now the masculine signs are the air and air and fire. So we're talking like air when we're talking Aquarius, Libra, Gemini, and then when we're talking about fire, we're talking about Sagittarius, Leo, and Aries. Now, so what I mean is when two planets are sextile from each other, it means that they're from the same gender. So say if someone has their sun in Taurus, that means they could have their moon in Scorpio, they could have their moon in Virgo, they could have their moon, it just honestly, what I'm just saying is that their sun and their moon are of the same gender, either masculine, meaning fire, or air signs, or we're talking about water or earth signs, which are feminine. So what's nice about this aspect is that it's like a balanced masculine and feminine energies. I feel like these people with their childhood, they easily saw, whether it's, you know, the masculine or feminine energy that they saw in a single parent, or it was the masculine and feminine energies that they saw play out between two people. Regardless of that, they just kind of saw how the two energies, whether people or just two energies within one person, how they got along very well. You know, there was a lot of balance, and it's so harmonious too, that sometimes too much balance can cause these people to kind of be complacent and be afraid of conflict because they're so comfortable and cozy in a harmonious atmosphere. You know, people gravitate towards them because they could just kind of feel that they have a very easy, very friendly, very pleasant disposition and personality about them. And these people in a past life, I feel like both sun sextile moon and sun trine moon, both of these aspects, these people have worked lifetimes over lifetimes over lifetimes balancing that masculine and feminine energy, meaning that they have learned how to balance the need for authority, power, and ego with their ability to want to be emotionally comforted and to have that emotional stability and to allow their unconscious mind to kind of do its thing without not taking away their identity, if that makes sense. So, like I said, these people can be very relaxed and laid back because there's no internal war. They saw either in childhood, or this is just an energy that they have learned over past lives, how to really balance feminine and masculine energy over time. So there's just a natural, harmonious, peaceful way about them. You know, when it comes to their needs and their wants, they're on, not only are they on the same page, but it's just like that ebb and that flow is just so efficient, and it goes back and forth without a tick or without an error in rhythm at all. It's just rhythmic how it bounces back and forth between the communication, between the conscious and unconscious mind. They just go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Now, to kind of talk about, like, because like I said, sun sextile moon and the sun trine moon are very similar. So when I'm talking about the sun trine moon, it just, this aspect of someone is even more amplified. When I say someone's sun trines or is in trine with their moon, that means that the two planets are 120 degrees from each other. It also means that they're from the same element. So someone can have their sun in Taurus, but they might have their moon in Virgo because Taurus and Virgo are both earth signs. Think of it that way, you know, like it's the same element pretty much. You know, if they had their sun in Aries, that means they could have their moon in Leo, you know, same thing. So so the difference between sextile and trine is that sextile is like these people have this way to balance masculine and feminine energy. They have like their tools in their tools box, you know, they could just pull out the tools and use them when necessary. But someone who has their sun trine with the moon, with their moon, it's almost like it's completely already incorporated into their personality. You know, these are not tools that they just pull out of their toolbox. It's just very natural for them to have their masculine and feminine energies get along very well. These people probably have spent more past lives trying to get these energies to kind of ebb and flow and to be to harmonize between them two over past lives, you know. Yeah, and so with this, it's like what I've noticed about these people too is like they're not going to have issues with self-sabotage, you know, because like I said, the unconscious mind, even though it might not have as strong of a voice, like the moon might not have as strong as a voice as the sun, but the moon is still allowed to do its thing, you know. I kind of feel like these people definitely, either they were like, like I said, raised in very stable homes where they kind of saw two energies, whether it's the single parent or it's, you know, the energies of two people, they really did see how people can be brought together, how relationships really work. I also want to say, too, if we're talking about synastry, these aspects kind of like definitely show that that masculine and feminine energy are definitely going to get along. Like someone's ego is going to get along with someone's emotionality and vice versa. And then they also have a powerful intuition. Because the sun is not really challenging the moon is allowed to be as intuitive as they want to. But then the sun can kind of do whatever they want to do and kind of exert their willpower as they want to. But like I said, because this energy is so harmonious, they're not going to really like rock the boat or really kind of disturb that harmony, because within themselves, they're already harmonized. So there's no need to kind of really exert and look for external, I guess just external harmony. So yeah. And then the next aspect, it's kind of like the opposite of the two I just talked about. So we have sun square moon, or sun in square of the moon. And this happens when the sun and the moon are in signs of the same mode or modality, meaning that the sun and the moon are either in signs that are both cardinal, either both fixed, or they're both mutable. You know, so say if someone's sun is in Gemini, which is mutable, then that could mean that their moon is in Virgo. That's right. I think Virgo is mutable. Yeah, I'm pretty sure. Because Taurus is fixed. Capricorn is cardinal. So yeah, Virgo is mutable. So if someone had their like sun in Gemini, but their moon in Virgo, that those two signs are mutable. So the reason why, and that's the thing too, people with this aspect, they almost have an Aries vibe about them, because it's like their needs and their wants are in constant conflict of each other. It's like these people, if they have this aspect, they came onto this planet and they kind of came into this life needing to learn how to build on the positive qualities that is of the sun, you know, to be independent, to be autonomous, to really kind of have your own willpower, to have your own strength. You know, to how do you kind of like go about this world and kind of really, you know, I don't know. It's just like your core personality and self-expression is allowed, you know, those qualities need to be increased. But then they also need to overcome the negative qualities of the moon, which is to be very, you know, very, what's the word? Varying, you know, like you could feel upset one minute and then sad the next. You know, the moon really allows us to kind of really express our emotions in many different waves and forms, but there is a time and a place for everything. And honestly, people with their sun square moon, they have to be careful with their emotional responses, because sometimes they could be so intense that they end up kind of affecting their life path or their potential success. Because their emotional responses are just so strong. They're in constant, like, inner conflict with each other, because it's kind of like the sun and the moon both want to take charge. They both kind of want to go a certain direction or do things a certain way. And I kind of feel like people who've either grown up seeing this relationship as a child or have this relationship with people and their synastry, it's kind of like these are people who are constantly arguing with each other, you know, and it's more of like a ego battle between the two. It's more like I want to go left, you want to go left, but who gets to turn the car left? Like, who gets to drive? Who's the driver? That is definitely a sun square moon. It's like the sun and the moon really struggle to figure out who gets to drive or who gets to take charge, who gets to be center stage. And I think because either the sun or the moon don't really get to have its time in the sun, then it's kind of like when the moon comes center stage, it's intense, it's emotional, it's erratic, it's all over the place, it's angry, it's upset, it's crying, it's just high emotionality, right? But then if someone's sun takes over, then that means they could be kind of overbearing, you know, they can be kind of selfish, they could be kind of asserting themselves over other people and not really knowing how what they're doing is really affecting other people and how it's causing conflict and strife between other egos, because their own ego is kind of like already struggling, you know? So, and these people definitely struggle with wanting to be independent, being independent and autonomous and kind of doing their own thing. But then also too, they also feel like there's a part of them that has to sacrifice that. If they want to feel loved and comforted and get along with people, they feel like they might have to deny themselves sometimes. So there is a constant struggle between the two energies trying to figure out, you know. I kind of feel like when we're talking about in synastry, when we're talking about two people with this aspect, it's like they're both trying to figure out, like, what do you want from me? I just want to do my thing, you know, and like, I don't know why you're trying to stop me. But it literally feels like there's one stage, but there's two stars, you know, there's two prima donnas who want to come and sing on stage, and neither of them is given the time that they want to do their thing. Now, the next aspect I want to talk about is the sun in opposition with the moon. So these people were born at a full moon. And when the sun is in opposition to the moon, that literally means that the sun and the moon are in opposite signs. You know, these are conflicting signs where they're just polar opposites of each other. This is someone who could have their sun in Aquarius, but then their moon in Leo. Or this is someone who could have their sun in Libra, but then their moon is in Aries. These people are very competitive and they could be very confrontational. The thing about these two, it's kind of like you kind of have to think about two energies that are so different that they just choose to be autonomous and they just kind of do their own thing, you know, like they're allowed to kind of have their separate stages in a way. But it's like they can't cooperate and kind of come together when they need to. When the sun and the moon are supposed to work together, they don't. You know, it's like they're both given their freedom, but at the same time, it's like that cooperation is what really kind of brings about completion of a person. That's why these people with this aspect can be very unhappy people who can't really find the things that satisfy them, because it's almost like they can't incorporate both the sun and the moon into their personality and kind of grab onto both, you know, because they're so on opposite spectrums and they so want to kind of be away from each other. You know, instead of being magnets, you know, and bringing people together like the sun sextile moon or the sun trine moon, these people repel. They repel the masculine and feminine energies within each other. So they are very polarizing within themselves. But it's like these two energies understand each other because they're the opposite of each other. You know, if I'm a super happy person, I could understand someone who's sad because they just don't have as much happy as me. That's kind of like how maybe someone, the energies that someone is dealing with when they have this aspect. They also have a tendency to provoke others and make others people upset because it allows them to kind of understand like, okay, when conflict, when confrontation happens, how is it dealt with outside of me? So they try to take the external and internalize it and try to understand their own conflict within themselves when they create conflict outside of themselves. Also too, these people could be very indecisive. Like I said, it's like the sun and the moon can't come together to make a decision, because they're just so different, you know, versus like the sun square moon. It's not like the sun and the moon are so different that they don't understand each other. It's more like they are so alike that they can't get along, you know, like people who are just spinning images of each other, but they can't get along. That's sun square moon. But sun opposite moon is like when people are too opposite, they're like too different to the point where they don't have anything in common. So if there are parts of your personality, especially when it comes to your emotions and then your wants and your needs, if your wants and your needs are not on the same page, you know, it's kind of hard to be decisive because it's like you're only attending to your wants or you're only attending to your needs. So, and then also too, I didn't mention this earlier, but the moon is also representative because, you know, the moon is also the fourth house when it comes to your houses. And the fourth house also rules ancestry. You know, your ancestors, the people who've come before you. So the moon represents past energy. So it also talks about the conflict between someone's past and their present. Sun being present, moon being past. So when it comes to this, it's like someone's past and present self are in conflict. You know, they're trying to understand who they were and who they are. You know, those two kind of are very confusing with each other. Both of those two, the sun square moon and the sun opposite moon, these can be very combative people, very confrontational. It's almost like they kind of have to create conflict in and around themselves in order to feel comfortable, because maybe during their childhood they felt that way. Also, people who have this aspect in synastry, these are people who could be very attracted to each other. But then when they start to really get to know each other, then they start to find out that, like, hey, maybe we don't have as much in common, or maybe we have too much in common that we don't balance each other out. So those are those two aspects. Now, the next aspect I want to talk about is the sun in conjunction with the moon. So this is when the sun and the moon are right next to each other. So if we're talking about houses, you know, this is someone who has their, like, their sun in Scorpio, but their moon in Sagittarius. Or they have their sun in Aquarius, but then they have their moon in Pisces. It's kind of like they're so close to each other that it's kind of like one takes over the other, you know. And the sun is considered like the most powerful planet in the solar system, or in the zodiac, you know, when we're talking about astrology. So this is this kind of is when it's just like the masculine energy dominates the feminine energy, or vice. Well, hold on, let me backtrack. So this aspect, if you see this with someone in their chart, it's like they grow up either in childhood, they learn that the expectations that other people have for them, you know, is more important than what they really want and what they really need. You know, it's kind of like these people really sacrifice their own will for the sake of peace and harmony, that they're willing to kind of give up their own identity and their own autonomy and their own independence for the sake of the harmony and peaceful relationships that they need. They crave that more than, you know, maybe the freedom. And these people can be definitely people pleasers. You know, it's kind of very hard for them to kind of like say, hey, forget you, I'm going to do my own thing. You know, I don't care what you're expecting of me. I need to kind of do my own thing. It's difficult for these people to say that, you know. And I kind of honestly feel like these people need to create emotional stability within themselves. Yeah, because it's kind of like they give too much of themselves just for the sake of having some peace and some harmony, you know. I definitely see this archetype in movies all the time, where there's a lot of stuff going on around this person, but instead of kind of like standing up to the energy that is taking advantage of things, they'd rather just kind of like keep the peace, or at least not really cause too much, like, you know what, cause too much uproar, you know, if that means that they're not going to have the emotional stability that they're having at that point in time. So yeah, I mean, that's my take on the sun and moon aspects. Let me know what you think. I kind of wanted to make this video kind of applicable to anything that you wanted, you know, whether it's your natal chart, whether you just want to talk about masculine and feminine energies and how they kind of like work within us, you know, because not at all point in time do I feel like masculine and feminine energy is completely harmonious in every person all the time, you know. So I definitely kind of took a lot of that. And also too, I hope this kind of like cleared the different types of aspects, you know, how the different planets kind of work with each other and how they are in relation to each other, because not every two planets are going to link up and talk to each other or have a relationship. But when it does, at least you could try to like understand it a little bit better. So if anyone has any sun or moon aspects, or if you know someone that you've done a synastry chart on you and someone else, let me know if any of this resonated with you and how it kind of translates and how it is in your relationships with other people. So with that, I want to just say thank you for listening. I hope you enjoyed this video and you have a good rest of your day.